Hi there. I cleaned up a little bit and I found this box with some old digital compact tapes. Compact tapes are the predecessors of DLTs. Compactape II, that's already the second version. The first version was the Compactape I, or the TK50. That's the TK50 drive here. And that's the very first DLT drive ever made and invented by DEC, Digital Equipment Corporation. It had a proprietary interface, standard 12-volt, 5-volt connector. And it consists of a cavity where you slide in the tape and a take-up reel back here. That's the read-write head that goes up and down. The tape head writes in a linear motion. That means the tape runs across the head. Then it steps one track up. The tape goes in the other direction. Then it steps one track up, and so on and so forth. And it's filling the tapes with tracks of magnetic data. One track after the other. It's not very fast, this one, but it worked. Storage capacity on the TK50 was 95 megabytes. The Compactape II could hold 295 megabytes, but that required a TK70 drive. That was the enhanced model. Now this strange box here is a VAX model 4000, or let me be a little bit more precise, it's a VAX 4000 model 705. Depending on the CPU board, which is about here under this cover, you could have different CPUs. The smallest and the slowest were the model 300 and something, don't remember that exactly. You have CPU memory here, then you have slots for all kinds of controllers. Here at the end, for example, is an old MFM disk controller. I use this system from time to time to test all the MFM drives. There is the tape controller. It's not installed perfectly, but I had to improvise here. I don't have all the original hardware. And this system, of course, had a big cover over all that stuff to look nice, so the covers have gone a long time ago, but it works without problem without these covers. Here we have spaces for disk, 1, 2, 3. In this box here are two disks, 2 3.5-inch disks. Here is 1 5 and a quarter-inch disk, and this one is empty. Little detail, we have here these plugs. That's the unit number. You can see that, unit number 1. That's unit 0. And the unit number is set by missing pins here. So for example, unit 0 has only 2 pins in the center and all 4 pins around are cut off, so that makes it unit 0. Unit 1 has only 1 pin more here, that makes it 1. Then I think 2 would be here, 4, 8, binary code. Let's look at number 2. Yes, exactly, number 2 has the pin on the other side. Here was the number 1 pin, 2. If both pins are in, that would be a number 3. That's the easy way to set the unit number. The reason why I make this video is this cassette here, Games Backup TK70. That means there are a lot of games on this cassette, and I want to install them on the Micro X here, and I'll show you how that is working. To read this cassette, we need of course a tape drive that fits to the cassette. As I said before, we have a Compactape 2 that fits into a TK70. If it was a Compactape 1, we needed a TK50, or the TK70 can read the old Compactape 1s but not write on it. So it's downwards compatible, but only when reading. And we need of course a tape controller that fits in our system. On this side we have the contacts of the cue bus. That's how it is called on the VAX systems, on that kind of VAX system. This one is a TK50 controller, so that would be the wrong controller for a TK70. That's the connector for the flat cable that goes to the drive. We have a couple of switches, address. Every controller has to set to a certain address. Everything is in the manual, if you still have one. Okay, that's what's inside the system here. Okay, first thing would be to load the cassette, so the system is running. Operate handle, that means we can move that. I put the cassette in and close the handle. Now it says it's write protected, that's true. There is a slider. If the orange bit here is visible, the cassette is write protected. Tape in use has stopped blinking. That means the tape is ready to read. Okay, let's do that. Okay, let's first see what discs we have. Show device D. We have 3 discs. I want to copy the data from the tape to my disc number 2, so I have to mount that first. I don't know its ID, its label, so I say override gleich override equal ID. Now the disk is mounted from the software. I can use it now. Okay. Now backup. That's the name of the tape. And lock at the end tells the system to write what it is doing. If I don't write the lock, we won't see the progress of the data copy. You can see the flickering of the LED of disc number 2. It's that one on the left side. And you also see the tape blinking, and you probably hear it moving. Okay, that's it. Everything copied to the disk without any errors or show error. We have one error on these two software driver devices. That's always the same. That's not a problem. They are never on zero, but anything bigger than zero than one would probably be a problem. So no errors on my devices. Okay, dismount my tape. It's rewinding and then unloading. Only the handle I have to move myself. Before I start playing with this system, I want to show you another nice feature of the VMS operating system. Cloning a disk, making a one-to-one copy to another disk and make it bootable. And I will tell you, it takes only 3 commands to do that. Maybe 4. Okay, show device D, and every command in VMS can be abbreviated until it gets confused with another command. So the correct command was show device, but I can abbreviate it to dev. I have only the D devices here, everything disk. You see we have one controller A and disk 0, 1 and 2. That's the disk type. RF73 is the big 5.25-inch disk and the two smaller ones. I'd like to copy all my data from the system disk 0 to 1 to have a working backup. So the first thing is /foreign, because I want to overwrite the label in this backup procedure. $2DIA1, that's the only one that is not mounted yet. That's it. Open VMS 062, it has the same label, so I did this trick before, but it's not wrong to do it again. Then backup /image, that means the entire disk with everything, from $2DIA0 to $2DIA1. And /lock to see what happens. So now it takes a moment. It has to write labels, and I don't know if there are any partition tables or something like that. And after a couple of seconds, it will start copying. Now. It's now reading from disk 0 and writing to disk 1. and of course it is a little bit slow now, because for every file it writes, it also has to output the file name and the entire text here to the serial interface. But with the Control O, we can switch that output here off, and the disk copy will go much faster. Why not try Pac-Man? Run Pac-Man. Now, this game runs in the VT220 emulation. It doesn't run on the VT52. It's always a little bit of trial and error, but I can set any terminal I want with this program here. Yes. So that looks familiar. Pac-Man is this little at sign, and Control is with the keypad, 8 for up, 4 left, 6 right. Oops. The problem is it keeps running, and it runs quite fast, because many of these programs have been programmed on older systems. Okay. Now 1, 2, 3, 4 are the four ghosts that are chasing me. And when I get this diamond, I can chase them and eat them. Yes. Pac-Man. How about some space games like Asteroid? Do you want any instructions? No. Let's go. Ooh, I have to navigate around the stars. Bang. It's a little bit difficult because I have to use the greater and smaller sign here together with the shift sign. I think the older keyboards had these two characters here on two separate keys, which makes it a little bit easier to handle. So it's very difficult to do that. There is another version of Pac-Man that was a very popular game. It's called Waxman. No, we don't need any instructions. Here I can navigate with the arrow keys, and the entire game only moves when I push one key. One step, one step, one step. So I can wait forever, think about the best strategy. Maybe if I can get that one here, it will probably... Oh, now I'm the Super Pac-Man. How long? Still? Okay. Oh, game over already? Okay. Whatever happened? How about the game of roulette? No, we don't need any help. And no statistics, please. One player, yes. Okay. How many? $100. Okay. And I put it on this row here. Okay. Let's play the game. I have 1-0. I have no more money. Game over. Control C. We also have movies, short animations. I can show you that. Asterix point film. Bambi. I like Bambi. Bambi is cute. Run film. Which picture? Bambi. Bambi versus Godzilla. Animation by VAX 11780. That's a long time ago. The VAX 780 was once the most powerful VAX, and Godzilla killed Bambi. What do we have else? Oh, Mr. Bill, that's cute. Some of these animations work a little bit too fast. This one is okay. Well, maybe a little bit fast to read. The next one is a remake of the famous Paul Newman film The Blob. Maybe you have seen that, it's somewhere on from the 1950s. That's it. And there is another one. Porsche. There's another one I like to play quite often. A game, of course, called Snake. This is still around in other versions. It's a snake that moves around and you have to eat, and you don't have to bit. And how about some flight simulation? Run 747. It's a real jumbo jet. Okay, standby for takeoff clearance. Thank you. We are waiting. You're cleared for takeoff. That's very nice. And that's the famous graphics. We have flaps, wheels, brake. If I hit the B, we release the brakes. S or F will increase the throttle here. Yes, no, perhaps. Yes, now I have maximum thrust. And airspeed goes up very slowly. You see the runway, that's the runway border here. And that's my center line. And I have to correct that somehow. I'm drifting to one side and I can't do anything because the arrow button. Okay, I'm off the runway. Takeoff failed. Okay, I should read the manual probably. Okay, I think that's enough playing for today. How about a short peek inside the system? Let's see the CPU. Now that's the shutdown running. Shutdown complete. Use console to halt system. That's my console here. Power button off. system halted. Okay, let's have a peek inside. And first disconnect that tape cable here, because it's in my way. So that's the power supply here, the entire block. That's the serial cable that goes to the, oops, the tap just broke off. I think it has become a little bit brittle in all that time. There are two screws. And then we flip that panel open. Then I disconnect that one and the big data connector here. Okay, then we can unhinge this panel somehow. Come on. What's the problem? Okay, now it's gone. So that's not only a panel, it's also an interconnection. We have two DSSI buses here. We have the network connector with an adapter for RJ45, serial port baud rate selector switch, display for the self-test. And everything is connected via this big cable, and here is just a little bit a power connector. And that's the battery I have to replace because it's dead. It's a nickel cadmium 3-cell in series, 3.6 volts. It's totally dead. I have to enter the date every time I start up the machine, but that's the only problem that brings. Maybe I leave it. Okay. Let's have a closer look. We see a memory board here. I haven't looked on the system. I think that's about 8 megabytes. Or four. It's full populated on both sides. Then we have a CPU board. With a CPU chip here. Air comes from below. There are a couple of big fans in the cabinet blowing air over all the boards. That's the connector where the front panel connects. Here we have a connector for an additional card. For example, a SCSI card can be connected here. There is another place for another option card. Backside. No capacitors, at least no electrolytic capacitors. Nothing goes wrong with that. That's an interesting chip here, the little one in the socket. That's the MAC address chip. So the MAC address is stored inside this little ROM. And if you change the board, you also change the MAC chip, and your new board gets the same MAC address as the old board had, and you have no problems when you change the CPU with any network connections, and everything just works as before. That's a good idea. Most DEC products have that. Then we have here, sorry for the shaking, a cassette controller. Oops, I have to remove the neighbor cover too. Okay. No, I have to remove that first. Maybe the cable here was in the way. That's the tape controller. Something is sticking. It's always a little bit difficult to get these boards in and out if they don't have the handles. That's the tape controller. Looks very similar to the board before. This is the TK70 controller. The other one was the TK50. Very similar thing. Okay, I think this screw here is still inside. Okay, stupid me, that was the problem. Okay, that's the SCSI controller. This is only one bus, it's an input and an output, so you can connect your devices here or here. You just choose which one you want to terminate, or you have to terminate both devices, so the controller is in fact in between. A lot of discrete logic, some CPU chips. What's that here? That's the famous NCR SCSI chip, 83C11. You find this on almost all the old SCSI boards. Full size Cubus board interface. It's the cassette QSA. K stands for controller, Z stands for SCSI, Cubus storage adapter, something like that. Okay, let's plug it in again. It doesn't matter which slot you take, because the address of the control is set with switches, so you can plug it in every free slot if you like. The only thing you have to watch is that the bus from the CPU to the memory has no gap, so you cannot leave one slot empty and then put some more cards in. If you need an empty slot, or if you have an empty slot, you need one of these here. It's just a jumper card, it has two jumpers here, and yes, that's it. That's two signals that are routed through each controller. It's a bus grand system here, and if this one is missing, the bus is interrupted and it only sees the controller until the break in the bus. So we don't want to break the bus. Put that in again, or we won't be able to use all the controllers behind that. Well, the old Cubus boards don't have these handles like this one, and they are always a little bit tricky to install. That's the same sort of Cubus board you find in an old PDP, for example, 1174 73. All the Cubus machines from DEC use the same controllers, and here on the VAX 4000 only the CPU and memory have a special bus, a little bit a faster bus, because Cubus is already a very old design. Okay, here you have three more spaces for the memories. There are the blue memory connectors. There's the memory, CPU. So memory and CPU have its own kind of bus here. And then it goes over to the regular Cubus, which you can find in all the old DEC machines. Okay, power to the panel. The big connector goes here. It's a little bit difficult to see. It's a black connector in a dark cabinet. Okay, I think I have it. Let's push it in. Okay. Seems to be correct. Let's get the panel on the hinge again. Okay. Close it, lock the screws, cover that hole so that the airflow is correct. Okay, tape goes in here. Where is my serial connection? Here. With the broken tab, it still goes in.
And again in stereo.